like a spark igniter. Earlier versions of the little Tradesman 170 had basically it was an automotive style spark plug. And over the years we went to more of a conventional type of spark igniter. Looks like that. It's got little gaps of about 1/8 of an inch. I'll pass this around so we can look at them. That's what ignites the gas. Right? And it works with the ignition controls to not only ignite the gas, but also monitor the burner flame. Okay, everybody's talked about flame sets before. Okay. Well, you've got an ignition controller, such as this. Okay. This is the ultimate. You've also got an igniter cable that stabs on to here. Well, then this end goes on to that igniter. And that's all laying in the room. So how does this create the flame sensor? How does it monitor the burner flame? Right. What it does is this. This board sends out a high voltage spark. And then between each spark, if you have like a real high speed camera, you can look at the spark and then it'll be a pulse. A pulse. And a spark. And a pause. And a spark. And a pause. But it happens so fast it just looks continuous. Sparking. Well, in each, between each spark, there's a little bit of alternating current, which is set out from here. So not only is this thing, which is like an automotive spark plug cable, so not only is this thing delivering spark or high voltage to that igniter, it's also acting like a flame sense wire. So what happens is that this thing is sending out alternating current, and it's going up to the tip of that igniter. And what happens then is that as soon as that igniter ignites the gas, well, that burner flame acts as like an electrical conductor, like a wire. But the thing is, as soon as that little bit of alternating current hits that burner flame, it's changed from alternating to direct current. And direct current then passes through that burner flame to the nearest grounded source, which is going to be up on that combustion chamber. And you're going to find a green ground wire that returns that direct current signal back to the electronic controller. So it sends it out in one way and it retrieves it back the other. It's looking to see, okay, between this window, between here and here, I'm sending it out here, I want to retrieve it back here. I better have burner flame in this area. If I take the burner flame away or the gas, it sends it out here, but it doesn't get it here. If I've got that burner flame, that's my electrical pathway. So that's how this thing knows what's going on. But you've got to have a good earth ground to make that happen. If I don't have a good earth ground, this thing will spark, ignite, burn for a few seconds, and go off. Spark, ignite, burn for a few seconds, and go off. And believe me, on construction sites, we run into that an awful lot. We run into that a lot on, heck, even another branch of the Illinois company, our agricultural building heaters. Now our electronic ignition too. A guy might have old pilot light heaters and puts it electronic. He had them. Pilot light heaters don't care about flame sense. He puts it electronic. He had an older electrical system. Well, now the thing is igniting going up, igniting going up. You wonder why. It's because he didn't have a good earth ground. Same thing holds true with these. Earth ground, a good one, is required. Let's see, gap on that igniter that was being passed around, I will tell you in the owner's manual, it's about 1/8 of an inch somewhere in that neck of the woods, in figure 12 right there. Let's see, these are a couple of the electronic controllers. I've mentioned these before. This one is the ultra version. You can kind of tell it's got that little female socket right there that gets connected to the little red light, the LED wire harness. And this one down here does not have that LED connection, and there's a few fewer terminal connections too. This is on the Tradesman 170 standard. This is on the 170 Ultra and the 400 standard and Ultra. Right?
So the 400 or 170 is the same circuit?
Yep. Like I said, it controls all the functions of the heater, senses burner flame, sends voltage out. And on these heaters, older versions of the Tradesman 400, and I'm talking probably 15 years ago, somewhere there, it used to work off of not only 120 volts, but also a 24 volt side. It used to have a transformer in there. We got rid of that, kind of streamlined the design a little bit, so they don't have to worry about, on these heaters, 120 volts now. So the 120 comes into the board. We'll talk about this in a little bit. It sends it through the air pressure switch. The air pressure switch closes and turns it back, because the board is always checking to make sure that that little air proofing switch is closed, or does close, when the fan motor starts. Here's the ignition cable. Right here, I held that up before. Basically, an onboard cable. When you check resistance on this, you're probably going to read in the neighborhood of anywhere 25 to 35 KO. It's got a carbon core on it. So you might want to just make a mental note to check resistance. All right. Kind of backtracking right here a little bit. You know, this is the ignition coil right here on both of these boards. And that sends out this high voltage through the spark plug cable. Well, a question that we do get from time to time is that, well, how do I determine, you know, my igniter, I don't see my igniter sparking. How do I know if it's my igniter, my board, my cable? How do I know what's going on, right? What we tell people is, and you do this test with the gas off. Gas off, right? Take off one of the side panels. You know, I'm not going to flip these heaters around. I think you see how you can get to the guts of this thing, right? You take off one of the panels or the bottom, you're going to see the circuit board. This is the ignition coil, right? You take a screwdriver. Where's my screwdrivers? Thank you. What you do is you start the heater, again with the gas off. And all you do is disconnect the spark plug cable, gas the other heater. You don't have to. And if the board is good, you'll see a spark jumping. All right, well, my igniter wasn't sparking. Let's just say I'm working on an ultra heater. Tradesman Ultra, my red light's blinking three times. We'll get into the flash codes and all that kind of stuff. But the light's blinking three times, this means ignition failure of some type. Well, I've got plenty of gas. The guy from LB Light said to hook up a 500 gallon tank. I did that, right? I've got gas in my heater. I'm using the rec regulator. I can hear my solenoid snap open. And I can smell gas during my ignition cycle. But I don't see spark. This is the whole scenario. How do I determine if it's my board, my cable, or my igniter? Those are the three things that are going to create ignition, right? So I shut off the gas. Put the tip of this about a quarter inch away. Start the heater. If it's not my board, I should see a nice strong spark jumping from here to my screwdriver tip.
Insulated.
Insulated. Right. Make sure it's not cracked. I got sad. All right.
And he says even just one of the groups later will have a faulty insulated screwdriver.
Yeah, it's, I forget which one it was, but Dang and I kind of machined a little knock in there. So you'll find it. Don't worry about it. Anyway, now what you do then is say, well, how? Okay, it's not my board. How do I know if it's my igniter cable? Well, I don't know. Let's reconnect my cable. And then what I do is I put this against the chassis of the heater, close to it, ground it, see if I get spark jumping from here to there. If I got it here but not here, then it's my cable. If I got it here and here, but I don't see it at my igniter, it's my igniter. And the reason I'm sharing this with you is because we get people asking these questions. How do I test this stuff? Well, you don't need a fancy tool or anything else, in which you probably are checking. You can do that. And believe me, he's been able to solve a lot of questions. There's a lot of problems over the phone by doing it. Just ensure the gas is off. So you don't want flashback. Questions on any of that stuff? Solenoid valve. Now this is the Tradesman 170 valve right here. Here's the Tradesman 400 valve right here. This has got a 3/16 Allen plug in it. You can take that out. You can put a high pressure gauge in there. No, low pressure gauge, excuse me, 400. At this point, you want to measure low gas pressure coming through that solenoid valve. And on the solenoid valve for a Tradesman 170, you're probably looking at about 11 inches water column, somewhere in that neck of the woods.
Back up a few minutes.
Oh.
Well, maybe we look back.
Yep. Flip the button. On the 400, a little bit different style. I'll pass that on so you guys can look at it. It's still got the same size Allen key, 3/16. If you take that out and put a high pressure gauge at that point and start the heater, if the valve is opening, you should be able to read 5+ pounds of pressure, 5.2, somewhere in that neck of the woods. Well, what's my pressure going to read if my throttle valve, my variable rate valve, is in the low end position? Well, you're going to read something higher because that pressure is kind of back pressuring that gauge a little bit. So what you want to do is check the pressure when that variable rate valve, excuse me, variable rate valve is in a full open position. Now, that valve's got two red wires and a green wire on it. It doesn't matter what red wire goes to where. One's a hot, one's a neutral. The other one's a ground. Just make the electrical connection to the door. This one, the 170 valve, will have a black wire and a white wire. I think it's pretty obvious what one's hot, one is neutral. Yeah, the gas source. Different diameters depending upon what pressure is you're running through there. Like your Tradesman 400, you can get by using the 3/8-inch gas hose working at high pressure. And even this smaller heater, because it's only 170,000 BTUs, you can use a 3/8-inch gas hose. Not a big deal. You're only talking about maybe 10 feet. As you go up in length from gas supply to heater, you will need to make the gas hose bigger diameter because of resistance to the gas flow through a smaller diameter hose. Just like through an electrical wire, you're going to lose pressure, gas pressure, through a smaller diameter gas hose from point A to point B. So you want to make sure at least on these heaters that it's 3/8 inch. If I was running 50 feet of hose, I might have to go up to a 1/2 inch inner diameter hose. The longest hose that we do make, the biggest diameter that we supply is the 3/4 inch hose, which is used on that near 350 dual fuel. That one we buy. We don't make the hose assembly here. We buy it already pre-assembled and pre-tested. And we can get up to 50 feet of hose for product shipping to Canada. 25 foot max, if you ordered a gas hose with product. The most that we as a manufacturer can supply is 25 feet, be it 1/2 inch, 3/8 inch, 1/4 inch, whatever it is. That's the requirement of a testing standard. If a product's going to Canada, we can ship up to 50 feet.
Let me add to that because I know I get questions of confusion. The gas code in the U.S. will say that you can run a maximum of 50 feet of hose. We, as a manufacturer,
yes,
are only allowed to sell you, because it's just the way we certify equipment as whole goods,
yes,
we can only sell you up to 25.
Right.
So
it doesn't eliminate you putting longer lengths on out
yeah.
there, as long as you go according to code.
So we can sell 25, but you can go 50. In Canada, we can sell you 25 or 50, but you can go 75. So just to clarify that.
Right. And keep in mind, the longer a hose you go, the greater the pressure drop. So be aware of that when you're doing all this stuff. You might have to change your regulation a little bit, alter the pressure from point A to point B. Not only increase the hose diameter, you might have to change the pressure a little bit, or the regulator setting, do a two-staging of the regulator, like we talked about before. We do not sell any component of this hose. We will only sell the complete hose assembly. The reason for that is because we know that that hose has been manufactured properly. I mean, we've seen hoses come back where it's had like little barn fittings right here, maybe radiator hose clamps, that kind of stuff.
No,
you don't do that. Everything is pre-assembled here, but we only sell you complete hose assemblies. Talk about the POL a little bit. This has got that little check valve inside of it.